Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with an offering of music. Friends, we welcome you to this time of worship here at First Presbyterian Church or wherever you may happen to be this morning, and we are delighted that you have chosen to spend this time with us. I hope you will like our page and leave a comment. Let us know that you are here and check in with your fellow worshipers this morning. Much is happening in the life and witness of our church. This is World Communion Sunday. The first Sunday of October annually is a day in which we celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper and remember that the Church of Jesus Christ is far bigger than any one congregation, any one place and time, and we celebrate our oneness by partaking together of the Lord's Supper. So if you forgot that today is a Communion Sunday, take just a minute as we begin to maybe locate some bread or juice or whatever you have on hand as we remember in our Presbyterian way of being the church that that the grace contained in the sacrament is not in the thing itself. It's what the elements point us to, and we remember God's goodness in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. The session of our church, that is our congregation's governing board, calls the congregation to meet next Sunday at 11:30 a.m. So Sunday, October 11th at 11:30 a.m. for the purpose of hearing a report from the nominating committee and electing a class of officers to their respective terms. That meeting will be a first in the history of this congregation because we will have that meeting via a platform called Zoom. Many of you have become expert Zoomers in the last several months, and some of you may still be holding out, but regardless, there's information in the bulletin for this morning about how to connect to that meeting, and even if you don't have a smartphone or an internet connection, there's a way that you can dial in via telephone and listen to the audio portion of that meeting. I don't anticipate that meeting being very long, but we will convene it at 11:30 a.m. Next Sunday morning via Zoom, and the information in that call to meeting is found in your bulletin. I also want to remind you all that all of the opportunities for Sunday school, for midweek Bible book studies, for different ways to connect with our congregation can be found in a document called Fall at First that's pinned to the top of our website. So I hope that you will take note of that. Especially note, there are some opportunities for you to come into the building to walk the labyrinth on a reservation basis in different ways that you can engage with our church in this still strange season. One of the things that we do on World Communion Sunday is we participate with the wider Presbyterian Church in something called the Peace and Global Witness Offering. So a special offering today, in addition to your regular tithe and gifts, an opportunity for some extra giving for our church's worldwide witness. And of that offering that's collected today, 25% of that offering will stay here within our local community, and our Mission and Outreach Commission has decided that will go to the Athens Nurses Clinic. And so with us this morning is Paige Cummings, the executive director of the Athens Nurses Clinic. And Paige, if you'll make your way to the pulpit and you can bring us greetings and tell us more about that. Not only is Paige the executive director, but she's also a good Presbyterian, a member at the Covenant Church on the east side of town. So welcome, Paige.
Thank you so much. I'm so grateful to be here. In the 18 years that I have been part of the Athens Nurses Clinic, I can't think of a single time when First Presbyterian Church was not actively involved with us. I was asked to come remind people what the Nurses Clinic does, and we have the standard elevator talk, you know, 5 seconds. The Athens Nurses Clinic provides health and care and medicine to uninsured indigent patients. But when I took your missions on a Zoom tour of the clinic, I realize that doesn't tell the whole truth. Since the Affordable Care Act took place, all but 12 states have expanded Medicaid. Georgia is one that did not expand Medicaid. That means if you are poor and you are sick and you live in Georgia, you can't necessarily get health care. So if you have a chronic problem like diabetes, you can't get your insulin or your other medications, and you can't check your blood sugar, and you can't get your kidneys and your eyes checked the way they should be. If you're hypertensive, you can't get your medication for your blood pressure, and you're gonna have a stroke and die. If you have an acute problem, a cold, flu, COVID, it's very difficult to get care. If you go to the hospital, they will see you, you will get a bill. If you go to a private doctor, many of them won't see you. That's what the Nurses Clinic and the other free clinics in the state of Georgia are for. We keep people alive by providing them with health care, with medication, with health care education, with the take-home supplies they need to have so that they can maintain a stabilized health. They can be a part of their family, a part of their community, a part of their church, and help Athens to continue to be the warm, supportive, growing community it has been in the 28 years since I moved here. We do that through the help and the support of donations from First Presbyterian Church and from other churches And I'm just so grateful that you have selected us this year so we can continue to help our patients. Thank y'all.
Thank you very much, Paige. Let us continue now with our worship of God.
When disaster comes, we will not be destroyed. When danger looms, we will not be afraid. For we belong to God, who has called us and claimed us.
Hear the good news of the gospel. Jesus Christ came to save sinners. We confess in the sure and certain knowledge that God's grace overflowed for us while we were still sinners. In confidence, therefore, let us confess our sin before God and to one another. Let us pray. God of all ages, you have chosen us as your own. Yet we so often live as if it were not so. We succumb to things which are not good for us. We believe we know better than you. We refuse to put our trust in your promises. Sweep away our foolishness and bring us back to a trusting relationship with you, the one who has lovingly created us and longs to be our strength and life. Lord, have mercy. Amen. By the tender mercy of God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and reconciled with God. Thanks be to God. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Share signs of peace. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, who causes all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first reading comes to us from Luke's Gospel, from the 22nd chapter. The setting is the scene with Jesus and his disciples at the Last Supper. Listen for God's word. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat the Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup after giving thanks. He said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me, please? O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be found acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. One of the phrases that I've been hearing so often in these days is, "Oh, these are just unprecedented times. This is unprecedented." And somebody quipped, and I don't know who it was, but they said, "I'd like to go back to the precedented times, please." Many of you know I was a journalism major in my undergrad, and I really do feel for my classmates and colleagues who are in the news gathering and reporting business, because they are drinking out of a fire hose right now. Things just keep coming at us. And I got to be honest with you, it's given me my fair share of restless nights. Now, don't worry, I'm not ill or anything like that, but between all of the things, between the information about the pandemic and now learning how many leaders of our nation have been infected with it, between all of the vitriol with this election season and all of the concerns about our economy, between I I just worry about how it's affecting my children and my wife, my parents, and of course, worried about you. It's just a lot to take in. And I suspect that I'm not the only one that is tossing and turning at night these days. It's been over 100 years since our nation has gone through a pandemic like this. Yesterday, we saw a little glimpse of quote-unquote normalcy in this town, but that was a different college football Saturday in Athens, Georgia than we've had in quite some time, maybe ever. Everything is just weird these days. And everyone I know seems to have an uneasy feeling about, well, everything. And so given all of the uneasiness in the world, given all of the uncertainty, I think it's perfectly natural for people to begin asking some big questions, some big faith questions, questions like, does God even notice or care what's going on around here? And who is going to save us from this mess? And that leads us into some conversation about our biblical text for today. As many of you know, this fall we're doing something of a high-level overview of the Old Testament. And last week, Carol read for us the portions of the saga of Joseph in the very tail end of the book of Genesis. And this morning we turn the page from Genesis to Exodus. And the book of Exodus opens on an ominous note. A new king in Egypt called a Pharaoh. A new Pharaoh came to power. And the narrator tells us that this new Pharaoh did not know anything about Joseph, did not know anything about that story, about how a Hebrew, about how an Israelite had made it possible for Egypt to thrive and prosper while the rest of the world suffered through a famine. And so when this new Pharaoh looked out over the nation of Egypt and saw the descendants of Abraham and Sarah living among the Egyptian people, Pharaoh did not see a prosperous, thriving immigrant community. Pharaoh did not see neighbors. Pharaoh didn't even see fellow human beings made in the divine image. He saw that the Hebrews, the Israelite people, were different. And that difference made their existence a threat in Pharaoh's mind. And so Pharaoh began to act out of his fear and insecurity. Pharaoh instituted a systemic removal of immigrant children from their parents by ordering that the Hebrew baby boys be thrown into the Nile River. Pharaoh presided over the wealthiest nation on the face of the earth, and yet Pharaoh saw to it that Egypt's wealth was built on the backs of Israelite slaves. And when those people of God asked for 3 days to go into the desert and worship the Lord, Pharaoh scoffed, said, "I knew you were lazy." And he pressed down harder, requiring God's people to make bricks for Egypt's monumental glory, but then turning around and denying them the resources needed to make those bricks. And then, when their quotas were not met, Pharaoh ordered them beaten without mercy. In Egyptian culture, in ancient Egyptian culture, that is, a Pharaoh was more than a human king or political leader or even military leader. In Egyptian culture, in ancient Egyptian culture, the Pharaoh was viewed as a living god. The supreme leader was worshipped as one of the gods. Later cultures, including the Romans, developed a similar train of thought around the Caesars. In these cultures, the person at the top of the governing structure wasn't just an office holder. They were viewed as gods on earth. And so as the book of Exodus continues to unfold, you can feel the tension building in the narrative, because the promise that God made to Abraham and Sarah, namely that their descendants would be more numerous than the stars of the heavens and that all the families of the earth would be blessed in and through them, that promise is in danger once again. Will God's people perish under Pharaoh's regime? Or will the God of Israel find a way again? Well, if you've ever seen Cecil B. DeMille's classic movie, The Ten Commandments, or maybe the animated feature, The Prince of Egypt, or if you've just read Exodus, you know that God sent a Hebrew named Moses to demand that Pharaoh release God's people. And when Pharaoh refuses, God sends a series of 9 plagues upon the land of Egypt, but still Pharaoh's heart remains hardened and he will not let God's people go. So then God announces to Moses the coming of the 10th plague, the death of the firstborn of every living thing in Egypt, the animals, the livestock, humans too. And that brings us to a troubling story for today. So listen for a word from God from Exodus chapter 12, verse 1 through 13, and portions of chapter 13. Listen now for a word from God. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." Moses said to the people, "Remember this day on which you came out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, because the Lord brought you out from there by strength of hand. No leavened bread shall be eaten. Today, in the month of Abib, you are going out. When the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, which he swore to your ancestors to give you, a land flowing with milk and honey, you shall keep this observance in this month. You shall tell your child on that day, 'It is because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt.'" This too is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Truly, this is a terribly frightening and troubling story. It's full of death and despair. And it's one with which modern biblical scholars and theologians and ethicists continue to wrestle. But I invite us to consider this story from today from the perspective of a cosmic battle. To read this narrative as a struggle between two competing value systems. Let's consider first the value system of Pharaoh's Egypt. In Pharaoh's Egypt, any diversity within the population of Egypt was considered to be a threat to Egyptian sovereignty and national identity. So in Pharaoh's Egypt, the people of God living in Egypt are not people made in the image of God. They are a problem that must be solved. In Pharaoh's value system, there can never be enough. Ever greater storehouses must be built for the glory of Egypt. And consumption, at least for those at the top of Egyptian society, is the name of the game. In Pharaoh's value system, might makes right, and the goal of life is to accumulate by whatever means necessary, and then try to take it all with you in the afterlife to come. But on the other side of the story, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob operates with a very different set of values, and what we see happening in the story is these two value systems coming together in conflict. For example, in the value system that the God of the Israelites presents, if you look closely, you can see in the text that diversity is assumed and accounted for right from the beginning. Did you notice there's not an assumption about household size? So take a lamb for your household, and if one household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join with its neighbor, and the lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. In the value system of God, there's enough to go around, and everybody eats. But, do you notice? There are no leftovers. No leftovers. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains, you shall burn. Could it be that in a time of famine, there was an effort to store and accumulate food, to buy it and sell it? But in the value system of God, everybody eats because of the goodness of God, not because of the dictates of the marketplace. And so what we see happening in these terrifying and troubling stories is really something of a cosmic battle happening between Pharaoh, who is considered not just to be a political leader, but considered to be a god on earth, and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So what's being laid out here for us in this story is a juxtaposition between two competing value systems, between two very different ideas about what it means to be human, about what it means to live together in community. So here's what I want you to remember, my friend. You are cherished. You are loved. You are worthy, not because of what you can produce, not because of what you can consume, not because of what you can do for anybody else, not because of what you've done or not done or not said. You are loved and cherished and worthy because you were made in the image of God. And you belong to God. Full stop. God would rather go to the cross for you than live without you. You are God's chosen, holy and beloved. And because God has rescued you from sin and death in Jesus Christ, because you have been marked by the blood of the Lamb in the waters of your baptism, it is because of God's deliverance of you that you then are called to live your life according to Kingdom of God values. Out of a sense of deep gratitude for what God has done for you in Jesus Christ. My friend, are we not being presented these days with some differing ideas about what it means to be human, about what it means to live in community these days? And I've noticed that every 4 years, at least in this country, it seems to me that the campaigns become less about ideas and more about a personality. And candidates for the highest elected office in the land keep seeming to say to us that if we will but vote for them, all of our wildest dreams will come true. Or if we don't vote for them, or if the other person wins, then our nation will be visited by a series of plagues of flies and locusts and boils and sores. My friend, I beg of you, don't forget for a moment that in these times in which we live, elections come and elections go. Leaders come and leaders go, and leaders have their place, and we absolutely should pray for our leaders and to pray for their health and safety. Absolutely. But my friend, the world already has a Savior. And his name is Jesus of Nazareth, whom we, his followers, call the Christ, the Messiah. God has delivered you, my friend. God has saved you from sin and death in the cross and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God delivers you that you might come to this table today. Come to this table, not because you're worthy, but because you're hungry. Come to this table, not because you're ready, but because you're thirsty. Come to this table not because of who you are, but because of who God is. For God has provided this meal to sustain you for the journey ahead. But remember, you don't ever come to this table alone. In the kingdom of God, everybody eats, and everybody eats together, and there's always enough to go around. When we come to this table, when this bread is broken and this cup is poured, one of the things that we remember is that the Church of Jesus Christ is far bigger than the six of us gathered in this room right now, or however many people are gathered around your tablet or phone right now, or wherever you may happen to be. We call this the communion of the saints, and we come as the whole household of God, God's covenant people, whom God has called and blessed in order that we might be a blessing to all the families of the earth. We come to this table remembering who it is that leads us. Our Savior does not rule with spear and scepter. Our Savior rules with washbasin and towel. Our Savior does not give us policy plans or sound bites. Our Savior gives us his body that we might be fed. Our Savior gives us his blood that we might seek and offer forgiveness. We come to this table as people of the kingdom of God. When we come, we remember what the Lord has done for us when we came out of Egypt. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Together with the church across the world and throughout history, let us confess what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Friends, remembering who and whose we are, and with glad and generous hearts, let us give to God now our tithe and our offerings.
Oh,
Let us pray. By your goodness, O God, we have these gifts to share. So we ask that you would receive them and bless them, that they might be a witness for peace in a broken and hurting world. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from north and south and east and west and sit together at table in the kingdom of heaven. According to the Gospel of Luke, after our Lord's death and resurrection, he was on his way to a place called Emmaus, and he met two of his disciples there, but at first they did not recognize him. And it was only after Jesus opened the scriptures for them, and only after Jesus took bread and broke it, gave thanks for it, and gave it to them, only then were their eyes opened and they recognized the presence of their risen Lord. This is not a Presbyterian table. This table does not belong to First Presbyterian Church. This is the Lord's table. And Christ our Lord invites all who put their trust in him to come and share in the feast that he has provided for us, because in the kingdom of God, there's enough for everyone.
The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Let us pray. Eternal God, Creator of the universe, it's truly right and our greatest joy to gather around this table with brothers and sisters the world over to give thanks to you. You made us from the dust of the earth, breathed into us the breath of life, and set us in your world to love you. We rejected your love. We chose to live in enmity with one another, rather than peace with you and all creation. But you did not reject us, and you called us back to you over and over again. Therefore, we bless you, and with all the company of heaven and earth, we praise your holy name, singing. God, we give you thanks for Jesus, who came to show us your love as he fed the hungry, humbled the mighty, healed the broken, and proclaimed the good news. With thanks and praise, we offer ourselves to you, sharing this holy meal. Remembering Christ dying and rising, we proclaim, "Great is the mystery of faith." Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, this bread, this cup, this people, Christ's body and blood that bring us peace. As you make us one in the Spirit, grant us the strength and wisdom to seek peace in our divided world. Show us how to love you with our whole being and our neighbors as ourselves. Have mercy on all who are ill, especially those with COVID-19, including our President and First Lady. Comfort all who grieve. Guide all who lead and make decisions. These things we pray through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Hear now, as our Lord Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We remember that on the night of his arrest and betrayal, the Lord Jesus gathered in a room with those whom he loved, including the one he knew would betray him. And Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for it. He broke it. And he gave it to them and he said, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In much the same manner, after the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks for it and he poured it out and he gave it to his disciples and he said, Drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me. As often as we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we do proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. And he is coming. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Come, for all is ready. Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks that once again you have fed us. You have fed us with your word. You have fed us at your table. So send us out now by the power of your Holy Spirit. Send us out as your covenant people and work a blessing in and through us, that in and through us, in and through your body broken and poured out, we might be a blessing to all the families of the earth. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Friends, the Lord has shown us what is good, and what does God require of us but that we do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with our God. And so may the peace, power, and love of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.